on behalf of our district pastor and our board and all our church members here at Goldsmith Villa, we want to extend our deepest sympathies to all of you, family members and friends. And indeed, we too understand and feel the pain of the loss. We want to let you know that our church is always open and ready to assist and to offer whatever it is that the Lord allows us to offer in times like these. So welcome and understand that we share in your experience. The bathrooms to my left will be the female bathroom on this side, continuing around to the back of the church, would find the male bathroom. And so if the needs be, that's where you go. If you have your phone and they have to be turned on, could you please remember to put them on silence? And so that, we always say, so you don't disturb the church. But usually now, what happens is that when it rings, because people are aware of that, they become embarrassed. So we don't want that to happen. So we ask that you put it on silent. All right? Officiating today, as you would see a number of names on the program, but there are other engagements, and so others of our elders and leaders are elsewhere. Our pastor is officiating at a Thanksgiving service, a funeral service at Augustown Church, another church in the district. And so officiating today are Elder Leroy Stamp and yours truly, Elder George Planto. May the blessings of the Lord be with you as we go through this service. All right.
Let me hear the church say, praise the Lord. Remember, you're in church, so feel free to praise the Lord. Let me hear you say, praise the Lord one more time. Let me hear you say, thank you, Jesus. Because indeed, this is what? A memorial service. It's a Thanksgiving service. And we are giving thanks for the life of a wonderful individual who have given much, not only to our community and our country, but I dare say, to the world. So again, I want to share with the elder in welcome you and say that we are very happy to host this Thanksgiving service. Indeed, the family is close to myself and to most of us here, and so we are very elated to be a part of this service. I will have you standing for a few more minutes as we go to our program. Matter of fact, the song is not there, but it will be on the screen, which is our opening song, Praise to the Lord. You will be seeing it on the screen in a few minutes. Praise to the Lord, the King of creation. A few minutes, it should be there. Okay. And so we are going to begin this song. And as I said, I want your stool is not the greatest of singer, but I can tell you that you are. Amen. Are you ready? Out we go. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is thy health and salvation. All ye who err now to His temple draw near, join ye in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord, who are all things so wondrous. reigneth, shielded
yonder his wings, his rod gently sustained.
Hast thou not seen?
Hast thou not seen
how thy desires have been?
How the
desires have been granted in what he ordaining.
Granted in what he ordaining.
Praise to the Lord. Let the under his wings, yeah, so gently sustain. Sing how thy desires have been granted in what he ordained. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. God has been good to us. I thought there were three stanzas, but actually, it's three? Okay, you just find the next one. But we'll sing that another time. What do you say? Amen. Praise the Lord. Our scripture reading is taken from Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Chapter 3, and we'll be reading verses 1 to 10. And we are going to be reading it responsively, okay? Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 10. Okay, you have Tariq Mendes. Okay, Tariq, you come forward. Sorry about that. All right, you can go right there. And your name is so big and bold right there that I didn't read. That's Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 10. And Tariq Mendes, nephew, will be doing that.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Okay. Good morning.
Good morning.
All right, that's it. Okay, so as you said before, the reading will be taken from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1 to 10. So everything there is a season. And a time to every purpose under the heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up. That which is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to get and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to cast away. A time to rend and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak, of course. A time to love and a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. What a profit hath he that worketh in that wherein he laboreth? I have seen the travail which God hath given to the sons of men to exercise in it. So with everything said, one of the most precious things we have is our time. So as I said, one of the most precious things in life is time. So live your life with purpose, of course. You're gone, but you will not be forgotten. Auntie Simone, thank you for always giving and sharing a kind word. You can now show the angels how to score a basket and tell them about the wonderful places in Jamaica. Rest in peace, Auntie Simone. And to everyone here, let us not be sad today, but glad that we were able to spend time with her. Thank you very much.
Praise the Lord. Indeed, Tariq. Are you planning to become a preacher, Tariq? No? Well, we don't know where God is leading you. It's possible. Yes. Let's continue to pray for the young man as he continues to strive. And we're very happy, Tariq, for the way you did that reading. Let us bow our heads as we have our opening prayer. Almighty God, Eternal Father, We thank you, Lord, for your great love and your mercies toward the children of men. We thank you, Lord, for this day, even though it's a bittersweet experience. But we give you thanks because the daughter that you have given us, who has been taken away from us, Lord, had done a good work. As we have this memorial service, Lord, we want to thank you for all the things that you have allowed her to do, representing this community in an excellent way, and in representing the country in an excellent way. The family is thankful. The community is thankful. We all are thankful, Lord, for the life that you have given. And so, Father, as we come now, part of this Thanksgiving service, we pray for the family members. We pray for the community. And may, Lord, we take a leaf out of our book, a leaf of service. Because indeed you have brought us here upon this earth. And you have said that we need to be our brothers and sisters keepers. And so, Lord, we thank you for the family and that which you have placed in the family. The characteristic of the family is one of giving and sharing. And so as we go through this Thanksgiving service, Lord, we place the proceedings in your hands. May everything be done decently and in order, reflecting, Lord, your goodness and your grace. Bless us now, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Okay, so at this time we come to the tributes, even as we welcome those who came in just a few minutes ago. Our first tribute on the program, and I guess you have all received a program. Our first tribute on the program is my good friend, the friend of the family, Mr. Noel Namdakan, followed by a video presentation by Mr. Dean Roden. Then we have Michael Lindsay, a cousin. Then we have Orlando Mendez, a nephew. And then we have Maxwell Williams, a friend. And then we will have Nigel Davis, in the order as it is presented on your program. Okay? All right, so firstly, we'll have Mr. Noel Namdakan, who will come forward and we'll proceed in the order that is outlined on the program. Welcome, Mommy Beryl. Nice to see you, my sister.
Good day, ladies and gentlemen. I'm the leadership of the Goldsmith Villa Seventh-day Adventist Church, the Edwards family. I greet you in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
I'm here to do a tribute on behalf of Simone, my good friend. I don't know if it's deliberate that they put me first, because what I plan to do, you know, I plan to come sit, enjoy this service, and then, you know, hope that I'll be later on down to do tributes. So I could just pick little from Tom, little from Dick, little from Harry, and do a good little summary. But for one reason or the other, I think this was done by my good friend Steve. And he knows why. Anyhow, November, right? Simone was born in November, like myself and others. So we could say those who were born in November, skip around. All right, Simone. Affectionate, Sim. Yeah, our girl. Right, is she smiling? Look up. Right, she always wore a smile. You know, it's kind of searching for words. It's kind of one way, you know, that we, it's really this way we really meet to really, you know, have a good little say and good little remembrance of Simone. But as a person who fears the Lord and believes in God, I know that he does what he has to do, and he does it very timely. So we just want to say thanks for all those time that we have and we share with Simone. You know, Simone, I could say, you know, Augustine people, we show off, you know. So we say, yeah, Simone. And this is a slang now that going to take us on. So it says, Simone, from Augustown to the world. We now get them bold pose, you know, we are doing on. To the world, right? Because I remember Simone had a netball and basketball stuff. So said, Simone, to the world. And whenever Simone is around, you know, and you want to find her, just look anywhere else in the Wolfer Pitney then. Anywhere else in the Wolfer Pitney. Yeah, you just go to sir. And you have to find Simone. You know, Simone will impact so many lives. And we are grateful for her. And we just hope and pray that a lot more of Simone sprang up in our community. So, Amber, I want to bless you with the love of the Lord. Daddy. All family members, we just want to say the word is love. Let us continue to remember Simone, carry her in our heart, and just whatever she has started, let us just proceed with it. Let us run with it. So that's my few words to you, and I'd say may the Lord bless her soul as we say thanks be to God. Bless you.
Amen, indeed.
Observed, my name is Dean Martin, former president of the Heritage Citizen Association and former scorekeeper for the Heritage Culture in King Central UK. Now, I'm part of the Jamaica Diaspora USA and CEO and founder of Let's Talk Under the Reggae Tree Foundation Jamaica and USA. First, I want to take time to give my condolence to the Edwards and the Mendes family. Today, as I share our connection, our memories of our community hero and ambassador, Simone Edwards, OD. Simone was living in Hermitage, and while she was living in Hermitage, she also lived with us, my family. Simone was a part of the extended Roman family, where we had shared so many wonderful memories. Her family, very respectable, Mrs. Edwards, Miss Bell, as she was called by the members of the community, and her three children, four children. Simone Edwards, Steve, Junior, and Gary. And I tell you, we had so many wonderful times living there. After Simone leave Hermitage, they moved to Goldsmith Villa, and that's where she got famous, and they excel in their success. Bigger brother Steve, he started his own business and had a skate land. And that's where we keep our scout meeting. And the younger brother, Gary, he was also a member of the scout troop, and he was a patrol leader. May his soul rest in peace. But I'm proud to say that his two sons continue to give their service at a higher level. After Simone, you know, get involved in basketball and, you know, traveling the world, in Hermitage, what we would do on the 1st of August, we would recognize our ambassadors seen that Augustown was a community that was named after Emancipation Day, the 1st of August. So we would recognize all our ambassadors that live in the Augustown community, Hermitage and Goldsmith community. So all these communities, ambassadors, would be getting an award, Hermitage. And then Simone received the ambassador's award in Hermitage. And she didn't just get the award and stop it there. She continued to give back her service to these communities. And, you know, I was, you know, telling that permanently the amount of things that Simone has contributed to these communities. But 5 years ago, we were both diagnosed with cancer. I was diagnosed with prostate cancer. And likewise, Simone was diagnosed with cancer. And when I told her, she said, "Brah," you know, that's what she would call me, "Brah, you know, we gotta fight it. You know, don't tell Simone that we were sick." She said, "That is not in our book, you know." And our prescription for what we were going through was to give back service, because that's what the therapist said to me. You know, do what you love doing best, and service is what I love doing best. And likewise, my sister Simone loved doing best. So she went back to Jamaica and continued to give her service in building and empowering our young people in the community. I started a program, Let's Talk on the Reggae Tree, and her students would come on my program every Tuesday by Zoom. And so we continued to do what we were doing. So what we're going to be doing, Let's Talk Under the Reggae Tree, in honor of our ambassador, Simone Edwards, OD, we're going to be giving away, we're going to be having a scholarship in honor of Simone Edwards. So it's going to be the Simone Edwards OD scholarship award for two students, one at the high school going to college and one for the primary school going to high school. So Simone, I salute you for being a wonderful ambassador, hero for our community and our communities in the Augustown, Hermitage and Goldsmith Villa, and Jamaica at large. May your soul rest in peace, my sister.
Praise the Lord.
Good morning to each and everyone. As we gather here for the Thanksgiving service of my dear beloved cousin Simone, many of us wish if we didn't have to lose a loved one, but death promised to all of us, and death doesn't come with any timetable to say at age different. You can be young, you can be medium age, you can be old. For the past few days, it's been a sad one for me. On the day of Simone passing, I reached out to my aunt and said, "You know that I'm planning to come up there to look for Simone because we're gonna leave work early. So I'm asking permission if it is okay, because you know sometimes when persons in their 60s, they just don't want to be bothered." I said, "You know that your family, we are here, and we're getting ourselves prepared." I got a call. "That, did you get the sad news?" I said, "No, Simone passed." And that moment, I freeze. Because I almost dare to witness her. Took her last breath. Simone and I, coming from way back, she was a baby when she was living in Hermitage, then they migrated to Goldsmith Villa in the 70s. Simone was the only girl in the house. But she was challenging when you come to playing football. She used to love to play keep up on one foot and play with the boys. And you used to play football and you count to 100, who can keep the ball up to 100. And Simone would complete with that. So from an early stage, you would find out that she, I identified that she would be doing some physical thing, which at a later date, she ended up playing basketball, and she did well. Now, Simone and I born in the same month. Her birthday is the 17th of November, mine is the 1st. Simone and I share the same passion, a similar passion. And that passion is a humanitarian passion when it comes to kids and elderly person. We always want to interfere where kids are concerned. I want to interfere not in their personal business, but to see their development. And Simone and I share some moment, and that was when she was in college and university. That was Seminole Junior College and Oklahoma State University. Simone would reach out to me back then when we would buy a phone card to put in that call box and call. And Simone would always say, I have a friend from Japan. She named Eliko. And Simone introduced me to Eliko and we'd talk for long hours. And Simone said, I'm going to take you to Jamaica, Eliko, to meet my family and Mike. And Simone did, and Eliko came and loved Jamaica. So we shared that type of relationship even when she was away. Simone would come and say, cuz, I want you to do something for me. I said, what is that? He said, I want you to mobilize 50 kids. I said, oh my God, where am I going to find 50 kids now? I said, okay, I'll get it done. And then I went out and said, Simone, this is what I got, you know. And with the help of others, then we got those 50 kids. So Simone shared a passion for children, and she have a heart of a humanitarian. And even up until she's on her deathbed, she's still giving her heart. She gives you a word of motivation. She gives you words, even what you, when Simone, and you thought that you are the one who's sick, and Simone is the one who's healthy, or that person that she is. We might not get to spend our last days to that much, but I'm telling you, she is a piece of gem. My family, my friend, her friends, her families, her associate, surely gonna miss her. And I promise that she started some stuff, and I can assure her that I will continue to build on a legacy. May your soul rest in peace. God love you.
Moving on now to Jamaica's women's basketball team. Player coach Simone Edwards' team is rich with talent, but lacking the resources necessary to compete at the game's highest level. We caught up with Simone at a recent workout with the team and spoke to her about the challenges her squad is facing, not unlike those of the Jamaican bobsled team.
I am from Kingston, Jamaica. I grew up in a small community called Goldsmith Villa. Grew up with my mom and three brothers. It was a tough community. At a young age, I discovered two bodies, you know, because I used to go to the dumpsters to get books to read, and we discovered, as kids, two dead bodies over there. So, you know, childhood, as much as my mom tried, you know, to take care of us kids, four kids on her own, I went without a lot of things, but I was so loved. I appreciated her for everything she did. All I can remember is my mom crying. I just remember her crying. It was just two bedrooms, me and my brothers over one, my mom next door, because she didn't have shoes to give me. Even when I was training for basketball, a lot of time, it's outside, I was barefooted because I couldn't afford a basketball shoe. And before I even left Jamaica, I remember just praying and said, God, if you help me out and to be successful, I'll give back.
Simone has built a community center in her hometown, and through her charity, Simone for Children, she often speaks to school children in Jamaica about her story, using adversity as motivation to achieve their dreams.
What I'm telling you is that at the start, everything is going to be hard, even with your schoolwork. When you start some math, it's going to get hard. You know, it's going to seem hard. But as you keep practicing it, you're going to get better at it. Oh, there we go.
Everything for me is, I don't know, that motivation is just from where I grew up and just wanted to make my mom proud and want to make a difference. And I always tell young ladies I'm working with that it's a skill game. If I didn't go in the gym and spend this time shooting or working on my game, if I didn't want to make it, I wouldn't have, because there were so many obstacles in front of me, even from when I was young growing up, that, you know, walls that I keep running into. But for some reason, I just feel there's a mission out there to accomplish, and that's why I take on the national team. I just feel like with everything that's going wrong, I can make a difference. I can change it.
Simone's leadership style has had a positive impact on her players and staff, creating a family-like atmosphere that helps keep the team together.
We have been like a sisterhood, honestly. Like, Simone is like my big sister. She's our captain, but she's so much more to me.
Moving on now to Jamaica's women's basketball team. Player coach Simone Edwards' team is rich with talent, but lacking the resources necessary to compete at the game's highest level. We caught up with Simone at a recent workout with the team and spoke to her about the challenges. Moving on now to Jamaican, not unlike those of the Jamaican bobsled team.
I am from Kingston, Jamaica. I grew up in a small community called Goldsmith Villa. I grew up with my mom and three brothers. It was a tough community. At a young age, I discovered two bodies, you know, because I used to go to the dumpsters to get books to read, and we discovered as kids two dead bodies over there. So, you know, childhood, as much as my mom tried, you know, to take care of us kids, four kids on her own, I went without a lot of things, but I was so loved. I appreciated her for everything she did. All I can remember is my mom crying. I just remember her crying. It's just too bad when me and my brothers over on my mom next door, because she didn't have shoes to give me. Even when I was training for basketball, a lot of time, it's outside, I was barefooted because I couldn't afford a basketball shoe. And before I even left Jamaica, I remember just praying and said, God, if you help me out and to be successful, I'll give back.
Simone has built a community center in her hometown, and through her charity, Simone for Children, she often speaks to school children in Jamaica about her story, using adversity as motivation to achieve their dreams.
What I'm telling you is that at the start, everything is going to be hard, even with your schoolwork. When you start some math, it's going to get hard. You know, it's going to seem hard. But as you keep practicing it, you're going to get better at it. There we go.
Everything for me is, I don't know, that motivation is just from where I grew up and just wanted to make my mom proud and want to make a difference. And I always tell young ladies I'm working with that it's a skill game. If I didn't go in the gym and spend this time shooting or working on my game, if I didn't want to make it, I wouldn't have, because there were so many obstacles in front of me, even from when I was young growing up, that, you know, walls that I keep running into. But for some reason, I just feel there's a mission out there to accomplish, and that's why I take on the national team. I just feel like with everything that's going wrong, I can make a difference. I can change it.
Simone's leadership style has had a positive impact on her players and staff, creating a family-like atmosphere that helps keep the team together.
We have been like a sisterhood, honestly. Like, Simone is like my big sister. She's our captain, but she's so much more to me.
Members of the community, Reverend, good afternoon. Steve had called and asked me to do a poem in memory of Simone, who I see as a smaller sister. And this poem that I'm doing for her is a poem that is very, very dear to me, and for persons who know me well can attest and can see why I would like this poem so much. The title of the poem is Behind the Zinc Fence, and it's by Maxwell Williams, by myself, and I'll read very slowly because I want all of you to get the essence of the poem. The zinc are the ghetto walls that protects from the eyes and ears. It serves as hurdles for the fleeing and a mural of the struggles. The zinc hides the shame. The zinc hides the pain. The zinc hides the cardboard for window panes, the broken doors, and the pain-starved walls. The zinc hides the pit latrine to the side. The zinc also hides the pride inside. The zinc hides the words on the inside that are words to the wise. Behind the zinc are hungry children, wailing mothers, and a space for absent fathers. It's a space where prayers are boisterous and the Lord's name is used in vain. There, colored cultures are molded, and the dreams stands as stairways from the struggles. Here, leaders emerge from the darkest hearts, the cold hands of death. The cold hands of the doormen awaits, standing as conveyors to the underworld. Here, greeting cards for justice is always in season. Behind the zinc fence are the untold stories of the struggles of the poor. Their faces rise from behind the zinc fence. Clamoring hands grips to get over, to get out, to see manicured lawns and flowered gardens, to differentiate between tubs and jacuzzis, and to experience defined and divided rooms, to sit under a study lamp and not street lights, to have building blocks for toys and not milk box or cotton wheel trucks and rag dolls for toys. Behind the zinc fence, the ambitious poor toils, studying after evening chores over dogged ears books amidst screaming siblings and shouting mothers. There we read to sit the same exams, sharing the same classrooms and having hopes of occupying prestigious offices. Addresses may vary, but we are one. From behind the zinc fence, we rise, get a rise and socialize, to take our rightful places in society, to educate, to lead, and reshape the world. As we who were reared behind the zinc fence rise from behind the zinc fence to shine.
Praise the Lord. Mr. Williams, well done. It sounds like a poem that I would like to have. I like it. Wonderful, wonderful tribute. We're going to take one more tribute in this segment, and it's going to be done by a friend of the family, Ellie McCullough. Will come forward and give test is tributes.
Good afternoon, everyone. Simone was a great and personal friend of mine. Starts from humble beginning to stardom, public figure, and she remained a person of quiet, humble, not a boasty person. She's always caring, sharing, and giving. And I just want to do this song in her honor. Race is here for all of us. Don't be afraid to get on your mark and run back with the fraction you took from my heart. I'm in a state of shock. My body's getting cold. When I heard she is gone from me, nothing my hands could hold. Not just to see her go away, I'm left alone on the floor. All those corners of the wall seem like an open door. All I want to see, you come back to me. Don't leave this stone unturned and turn away from me. One more look in my face before you venture into space. One more cry on my shoulder before you proceed to a different border. One more look in my face. One more look. One more look. Lonely people still have a say. Lonely hearts still can take part. Reserve your words. Come on, look me in these eyes. How stubborn me. We'll take my time to realize. If there's no one to say I love you. One more look in my face before you venture into space. One more cry on my shoulder before you proceed to a different border. One more look in my face. One more look. One more look. One more look in my face before you venture into space. One more cry on my shoulder before you proceed to a different border. One more look in my face. One more look. One more look.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. It was at your father's, Brother McCullough, it was at your father's funeral I first heard you sing. And you have become one of my favorite singers. Yeah, I just like the melody and the way he just sings. Just becomes natural to him, don't it? You know, it's good to be in a community, with wonderful people. And sometimes when we go there, we hear people speak bad about the community. And in a sense, they are not wrong because of the few that is causing the problem. But generally, we know that they are some excellent, wonderful people in this community, talented people. And if given the chance and we have peace, I just can't foresee that the next 10 years, this community is going to be On top. Let me use that term. Amen. Okay, the Ghostmanville and Seventh-day Adventist Church is here. I think Steve would have remembered, along with maybe a few of us, when we started as a church, and the struggles we had. But we are far from where we want to be. And when you look outside, you see that we have a fence that we're trying to put up. And we are trying to ensure that our young people, the children that Simone loves so much, that we have things like parenting workshop, that we have something for parenting and the children to come and do homework, and all these plans that we have for the community. So it is in line with the plans that Simone Edwards would have had as it relates to the community. What beats most people, and including us, is finances. Financing is always a big problem to get things done. But we are moving on. And so at this time, we will be having our offertory, and this will be in aid of our community building fund. So we're going to ask you to contribute generously as much as you can as we move forward in this community, your community, our church, your church. Because this church was not placed here for any single person. It was placed here for all of us. What do you say? But before as the deacons and the ushers take their position to collect this offering, let me see now. I'm looking at somebody. I want somebody to come up here and help me sing this, and lead out in this song for me. This is the song, The Lord is My Shepherd. We'll be singing the tune of The Happy Wanderer. So do I have a volunteer? I want somebody to come right here. Do I have a volunteer? Come on, Virgin. Who want a volunteer to lead out in this song for me? Who'd like to come? Ellie? You know the song, Ellie? No, not you, brother, please. All right. If you don't want to come, you know, you're gonna risking me messing up the song, you know. That's all right. Okay, but I'm since you're not coming, I'm gonna ask you to put every. Okay, brother Namdata. All right, no problem. The script is in the program.
Right. Yes. The Lord's my shepherd, I not want. He makes me down to lie in pastures green. He leadeth me the quiet waters by. He lives. I know that my Redeemer lives. He lives. He lives. He lives within my heart. My soul He doth restore again, and me to walk forth made. Within the path of righteousness, if for His own name's sake. He lives, He lives, He lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, He lives. He lives, He lives within my heart. Yea, though I walk in death's dark grave, yet will I fear no ill. For Thou art with me, and Thy rod and staff me comfort still. He lives, He lives, He lives. I know that my Redeemer lives. He lives, He lives, He lives within. My table thou hast furnished in presence of my foe. My head thou dost with oil anoint, my high cup overflow. He lives. I know that my Redeemer lives. He lives. He lives within my heart. Goodness and mercy all my life shall surely follow me, and in God's house forevermore my dwelling place shall be. He lives. I know that my Redeemer lives. He lives within my heart.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord one more time. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, my brother. I have difficulty pronouncing your name sometimes. Numdark, come. Thank you very much for volunteering and leading out in our song service. I like that. I love it. He lives where? Amen. That's a personal testimony. No? That's a personal testimony, and I'm sure that you're speaking the truth. Am I right? Let me see the hands of those who don't believe that Jesus is living in your heart. I'm not looking. Amen. If Jesus is not living in your hearts, I would encourage you, by the grace of God, to make that a reality. Jesus living in your heart. What do you say? Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. At this time, we will have a remembrance, and we'll call Brother Tenfroy Mendes to come forward and give us a remembrance.
Good afternoon, everyone, especially the pastors, the elders, members of the audience. Right. Today happens to be a sad moment, but we all have to live with situations like these. Right. We're going to start with my dear and one and only sister, Simone Edwards. Well, she was nicknamed Bones by myself because she has always been a slim person coming up. Well, much of what I remember about my dear sister, you know that most things that you always remember are normally things that are a little bit bad, because the good memories normally slide. Anyway, I'm not going to touch much on that. The mere fact that we are still mourning, we are at loss, so I will make it as short as possible. All right. During her childhood days, I remember clearly when I used to have to leave from school in the afternoon to pick her up, she along with my younger brother, Rich, at the time was very difficult, because most times when I went to the school, they would be hiding because they want to play a lot before they actually reach home, because our mom was very strict at the time. So you know it go. Anyway, moving on. My sister was a very humble person, humble in the sense that she didn't give much trouble at all. Well, basically I would say it's all because of the discipline that was instilled in her from our mom. I have to give her a lot of credit for that, although she's not the person now we are talking about. Anyway, we're moving on. My sister, she was a person that everybody could actually look up to based on her early achievements from school, and she always showed this or displayed this interest in sporting activities. Well, basketball for one wasn't one that I was aware of in the early stages. It was mainly like netball, for instance. She was an excellent athlete at the time. Anyway, she migrated at an early age, I think it was 17 years of age, after leaving school. Some scouts they identified the talent with her being a good netball player at the time, and then she moved on to basketball afterwards. She did not let us down. She let us all, we're actually proud of her based on her achievements abroad. Because she went there, she worked very hard and pushed to the limit where she was successful. And the evidence is there because even the broader or wider section of the world recognize her as an excellent basketball player. She represents the various teams and so forth, and the evidence is all over. And I stand here today feeling proud to be a brother of hers. Her early departure from this life is very sad, because I know that is something that can come at any time. We have to just prepare ourselves for that moment. And I would take this opportunity now to implore most of you here to seek the Lord, because you never know when that time will come. I close by saying it is sad. It's an early farewell for her, but I wish her to rest in peace. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you very much, Ten Froy Mendez, otherwise called Perchy. Amen. We are going to be adding another tribute right here before we come to another remembrance before we come to the final tribute. And we're going to ask Aunt Desi to come forward as she... Okay, I know this lady. Aunt Desi, come forward and you'll give your remembrance.
Very pleasant afternoon, members, friends, and families alike, and to the community of Gold Summit Villa, August Town. All right, I'm just going to give you a tribute in song.
Yeah.
Life is like a mountain railroad with an engineer that's brave. Yeah, you must make the run successful. Yeah, from the cradle, oh yes, to the grave. Yeah, watch the curves, the fields, the tunnels. Never falter, oh, never fail. You keep your hands upon the throttle. Yes, and your eyes upon the rail. Come on now, sing with me. Blessed Savior, oh, thou will guide us till we reach the blissful shore. Yeah, where the angels wait to join us. Yeah, yes, please, forevermore. Oh, oh, as you roll across the trestle, oh, spanning jar, and swelling tide, oh, there you'll meet the superintendent. Oh, God, the Father. Oh, God, the Son. Yes, with a hearty, woo, joyous plaudit. Yes, weary pilgrims, welcome. Oh, come on, sing with me. Oh, blessed Savior, oh, thou will guide us, woo, till we reach, yeah, the blissful shore. Oh, we're the angels wait to join us, oh, in God's praise forevermore.
And they say, and they say, you know, easy, you know. Wonderful virgin, amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. So at this time we come to another set of tributes, two tributes to be exact. And I call upon a good friend of mine, brother, a man who's well respected, a man of kindness, love, and the brother of Simone. I call upon no other person than Steve Mendez, who will come and give us tribute at this time.
Check. Oh, do I follow that rendition? You know, hopefully, you know, I will be able to go right through smoothly. My brother came before. A lot of people think that I'm the eldest. I just look a little bit older. You know? He is the man. You know, I just want to let everybody know, everybody said Steve and Steve Junior is the man. Right? So I just want to make that clear. My aunt just, as I said, blew the place apart. Auntie Desi. You know, so I'm following up. I will do what I do best. Which I have been the doorman and I've been doing some other stuff, but you will hear what I have to say. Sometimes because I've been involved with entertainment for so long, I tend to talk too much, you know, so I'm going to stick to the program. Firstly, I want to thank the Almighty for allowing us to be able to gather to celebrate. Earlier we were sort of concerned that we would only have four persons or five persons, but it's ironic that last night we had a little wake. And there were so many people that the police had to say, go home. You know? So don't look at what is happening in the church and see it as a reflection. Simone was international and national. What we are doing here is a full representation of the community's love. We are separating the international star from the girl that we knew, that we grew, that started from humble beginnings. So I said, I don't want to talk too much. Thank God. I endorse all the tributes. And the good thing about Simone, you cannot say anything more than what is online. I Googled her and I told some persons where I worked, and I'm pretty well respected. And they said, what are you doing for yourself? You know, when they looked at the accolades and everything for Simone. So I can't add to what has been said and what is real. What I'm going to do today in two parts is to thank a lot of persons, and I'm going to give away some stuff. That's, you know, we're used to doing that. We're not rich, but we're blessed, right? And I want to start out by reading from a song, because I can't sing. I can play music, but I can't sing. When I used to leave Excelsior in my high school days, I used to walk on Mountain View, going up to Stanton Terrace. And there was a song that, you know, really spoke to me. I'm just going to do one verse. It says, it only takes a spark to get a fire going, and soon all those around can warm up in its glowing. Just one verse. I'm not going to sing. That's how it is with God's love. Once you have experienced it, you spread His love to everyone. You want to pass it on. This has been a part of me from those days, and it has been more for Simone. Some things are not known. Simone actually went into her pocket. She was doing very, very well, and she carried the Jamaican team to the Caribbean Championships. She went into her pocket, and she played the airfare. She paid for boarding, all of that stuff. Look at politics, because she couldn't get back her money from the government. But it takes a lot to give from the little that you have, right? So I'm not even going into the kids thing and the other stuff, but she has made personal sacrifices,
yes.
Right? So what we want to ask people to do is to remember that you can also do what Simone did, give from what you have, right? I want to thank a very, very special person that is here today. Simone is Simone Edward OD. But I'm not going to stick to Simone so much, because we're talking about legacy now. So we're going to build up who are here. Right? My mom is Beryl Edward OM. That's all. That is not just mother to me. She has a problem because me and the big dad, my brother, never called her mom and mommy. Like, we mother. We always refer to her as we mother because she was our mother too. And the Jewish boss, people talk about her all the time. So I'm paying respect to her. In addition, I have two aunts here, Auntie Sis. You know your place. Very, very special. You know? I wasn't birthed by you, but I feel like, trust me, I'm inspired by you. And I'm a success, I believe, because I have strong women that instilled a lot of guidance. Right? Auntie Desi is the same. If I go on and call other ladies, you know, I'm not going to stop. But I'm saying, Mom, you're special. And if I'm good, you'll always be good. All right? I want to play homage to Daddy E. You know, you're shorter than I am, but you're a real man because you take on this strong lady. So we do. All right. You both were able to nurture her growth and development. Because we talk about like Simone as if she's some super being. She's a regular person that got support and love from people around her. Right? And as I say Mar, I can say Keisha, I can say Jay, I can say all the other young persons in her, sorry, not Mar, but Keisha and Jay, in her age group, but there are a lot of persons. So if I miss any name, I'm saying blessed love to everybody, right, in the family. Secondly, I want to thank the members of the communities of Hermitage and Gospel Villa for allowing Simone to blossom and grow to maturity in the community during the 70s and the 80s. Because people take it for granted. She was protected going from Hermitage to Golan, 80s election, 83, all of those stuff. So God's guidance was there, the family's guidance was there. That's why she was able to come and fulfill a lot of other stuff. I want to thank all our friends, associates, and everyone who have expressed their love and support for the family during this time. And I want to thank Simone for her inspirational impact and her fans and all the persons she came in contact with. People know me as a little cornerstone of the community because of the skate land that we built in 1992. It was over 30 years ago. When we started that place, when we opened the first time, it was to honor Simone's breakthrough. A lot of people don't remember that. But we rushed and put it together just to make sure that we could say, yes, we are celebrating you. You know, so the powerful skate land that everybody knew me as Uncle C was started through that blessing of Simone. Right? And we did a lot of things in the background also, based on what Simone was doing. Right? As I told you before, I'm not one to dwell on too much in terms of words and prettiness. I'm a do it person. Just like I came in the church and I said, come up front. You know, even if two persons are here, we'll have fellowship. You understand? And I really feel good being a member of the community. Action speaks louder than words. And over the years, we have demonstrated that. Because we have spent so much, we haven't gotten it back. So it must be contributing to the community. So a lot of persons don't even know that I am a professional outside of, you know, doing business in Gola, right? I must also say thanks to community members. I have two co-workers in the corner over there, Miss Peggy, this farmer, blessed love, coming from so far to support. I didn't want this to be about me. So I basically just stayed in the background. But I cannot honor Simone's legacy without saying some things that I'll be doing with some friends. In the next few months, we'll be donating some funds and equipment valued at $250,000. This will be split between the Seventh-day Adventist Church that we're here at, also the Goldsmith Villa Citizens Association, and the Goldsmith Villa Sports Club. We have started some negotiations with the people in charge, because any donations will have to be made through a proper committee stamped by the JP or through the church. Right? In addition to that, we'll be committing $750,000. Don't listen to the numbers and feel like we have the money, you know. We just have the love. We will be committing $750,000 to a scholarship program working with the university and the MP. We will provide accommodation and food, right? Because we have rooms and we can do it. And we want to put the community forward also, because we want people from outside to come and live and know that it's a proper place that you can live and go to school from. In addition to that, we'll be doing $500,000 contribution to the community center in terms of a solar system, so that they'll be able to GPS free, have a modem system, you know, have internet and all of that. And we'll be doing some other things, but what we like to do is use invisible kindness, right? These are solid, substantial ways of ensuring that Simone's legacy is continuing, right? And, well, one of the things that Simone wanted, you see, because I was there when she was, you know, about to pass. I held her hand and I told her that, do not worry, because she loved her mom, right? And she loved kids. There is a guarantee that her mom is good. She will always be good, right? But what we have to ensure that the administrators of the Simone for Kids Foundation follow suit to ensure that Simone's legacy lives on. Because what I'm talking about has nothing to do with Simone's. We're just behind the scenes. And there are other things that I'm not mentioning because those are partnering with other individuals. You know, like Sir Maxwell, Noel, Michael Lindsay, everybody that has contributed, we're still going to be part, you know, to make sure the community grows. After Simone's passing, you will see a continuation of what she has always been doing. Right? So finally, I told you I'll be talking a lot, but I'm talking about tangible stuff, not just a tribute to Simone. We would implore and beg people, contribute in your own way to the future development of the community. Right? You have different ways that you can do. You don't have to give money. It's not a bed of roses, but it is fertile ground for development. Right? A lot of persons know. I tell you, when I started in Goldsmith Villa, there were two of us that went to high school. Little man went to JC, I went to Excelsior. Two of us, as youngsters at that time, went to high school. Now we have people with degrees that born over here, live over here. We have a national chess champion. We have so many persons that we're not highlighting, right? So we are going to try to help with that by doing videos, YouTube videos, and highlighting the positive side of the community. And the negative will always be there. And of course, you have the powers to deal with that. So I'm asking people, just give of your time. If you can mentor, if you can tell your story, it will help others. Before this church was here, I used to walk to Shedrock, carry water on my head. And you tell people, no, Steve, you're born with gold spoon name. No. So I'm saying, we don't have to say, we have to beg to give. We can give from what we have, right? So we'll be doing some other things on the sides too. So blessed love. And as I say, I'm going to show my love for Simone by doing as much as I can to keep her spirit alive, right? So thank you very much for listening to me. Blessed love.
Well, thank you very much, Steve. Okay, so at this time we'll be having a final tribute in a video presentation from Mr. Nigel Davis, friend. I'm going to go to the hospital. Okay, thank you very much for that presentation. Skills demonstrated there, exhibit. And that was Steve Skateland. In its heyday, I remember, because I live right across the Skateland. Remember those days. I never tried the skating. I mean, when I was about 12 or 13, I tried it. But I fell on my head back and I said, I saw you ever hear that they talk about blinkies? Blinkies. Yes. Many, many stars. And I said, you stay where you are. I will walk away from you. I never tried it. And then especially now, like my head does not have much hair. I had a lot of hair then. Okay, we have to give the homily, the word of God, because whenever, whatever service we have, it's important to hear a word from God. What do you say? Amen. We have our elder, the first elder of this church, Elder George Planto, well beloved by the community, a community person also, a person who loves helping people and would have dedicated his life towards dust. One thing I can tell you is a man of God. And he will not come with anything else but the word of God. Also can promise you that it won't be long. But it will be the word of God. What do you say?
Amen.
Before he comes, I call upon my wife, my lovely wife, Sister Judith Stamp, who will come and will give us the meditation song. After the, you have not heard her sing before, but for the members of the community, but she's a beautiful singer. When she's through, then we'll hear the voice of our elder George Planto. So at this time, I present to you my wife, Sister Judith Stamp. Next voice you'll hear after Judith Stamp will be Elder George Planto. May God continue to bless us.
Okay.
Praise the Lord, church. Praise the Lord, indeed. It's a difficult time. And, you know, it's hard when you lose a loved one. Sitting there and listening, I didn't have the opportunity of meeting Simone Edwards, but I've heard about her. And, you know, sometimes we seem as if there is no way out. But as I listen to this song this afternoon, I pray to God that the families, community members, we all will find comfort in this song. Like a ship sailing out on a trip so rough and long, so far from shore, so far from home, I set out in search of a reason to go on, and I found it in the eye of the storm. No matter what storm clouds may rock that ship of yours, the light of my Savior will lead you safely through the night. Though your ship may be rocky and your sails may be torn, you can rest in the eye of the storm. When the wind and water rages and the billows begin to roar, the blessed rock of ages speaks peace to your soul. He can hold you in his arms, so safe and so warm, and there you find it in the eye of the storm. So what? No matter what storm clouds may rock that ship of yours, praise God, you can, in the light of my Savior, he will lead you safely through the night. And though you're your sails may be torn, you can, in the eye of the storm, Sister Beryl, no matter what storm clouds may rock the ship of yours, the light of my Savior will lead you safely through the night. Though your ship may be rocky and your sails may be torn, you shall rest in the eyes of the storm. Though your ship may be rocky and your sails may be torn, you shall rest in the eye of the storm.
matter, hot storm clouds may rock this ship of mine. The light of my Savior will lead me safely through the night. Though my ship may be rocky and my sails may be torn, I shall rest, you shall rest, you shall rest, we shall rest, we shall rest in the eye of the storm. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Say hallelujah. Our God is faithful. In spite of the storm, in spite of the waves, in spite of what seems to be the overwhelming situations that we have to face day by day, in spite of loss that we cannot fathom, or sometimes that we even refuse to accept, we have the assurance that His guidance is with us. And the eye of the storm is the calm. So in spite of what's happening around, can you imagine how wonderful God is? When there is a storm, a huge hurricane, they have storm watchers that fly around and above and find themselves with the aircraft in the eye. And that turbulence is going on around them, but yet they have an aircraft in the eye, safe and sound. Remember that God promises to keep us in those circumstances. Good afternoon, brothers and sisters, friends, all of you. I know I have been there in terms of loss, but every experience of a loss of a loved one is different. It is different from the one before, and whatever the circumstances are that would have caused one's life to be lost, the pain is real and it's there. It's different with each loss, and it's different for each individual. But praise be to God, He takes care of our needs individually. And so you don't have to worry that you are not as strong as the other person, because God sees where you are and He meets you there. And His promises for comfort are as true today as they have ever been. As they have ever been. Today, briefly, I want to look at a subject. And I want to take it, as the Spirit leads, from the book of Jude and John. It won't be long, but I pray that the message will be clear as I allow the Holy Spirit to speak through me. Jude chapter 1. Jude comes just before Revelation. And verses 24 and 25 says, "Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever." Amen. Joy in the midst of sadness. Joy in the midst of sadness. Let us pray. Loving Father, we thank you for this opportunity that we can pause and understand your word. Let your Holy Spirit take over as I empty myself. Speak the words of truth and the words of comfort through me. In Jesus' name, amen. Joy in the midst of sadness. I want to recognize those who are online. You're not here in the sanctuary with us, but your presence online is appreciated by all of us, and the blessings that the Lord has for those who are seated in the sanctuary are very much available for you as you listen to his words. In times like these, when we are faced with the kinds of challenges that causes us to break down, that cause our minds not to be able to be focused as it ought to be, that cause us to ask some questions that maybe we, under normal circumstances, we wouldn't be asking those questions. The times when we stop and say, "God, why?" Times when, even when the answer comes, we still cannot understand why. We ask questions such as, "Why me? Why us? Why Simone? Why? Why?" The thing about it is that, based on the experiences of others and my own experience, even when you know the answer, even when you believe in a God that's faithful, there is something inside of you that are lost causes that you have to knock yourself sometime and say, "No, let me not think this way." And you wonder, because you said, you know, in Jamaica we say we don't want to fly in our God face. You wonder sometimes if what you're doing is obnoxious in the sight of God. But God, who has made us and who understands what it is to lose one because of death, understands what we're feeling. The truth is, as long as sin exists in the world, we all who live in the world will be affected by its consequences. It does not mean that when things like these happen to us and our loved ones, we can point a finger to say, it is because of what you did, and you're not doing this or not doing that. Job was a faithful man to God, that God could have used him as an example, as a challenge to the devil, to say, my servant is faithful. Do with him as you please. I will just not allow you to kill this. Get this right. Satan cannot take your breath. But he can do things that he knows that a human being cannot bear. And it leads to our death. God allows our life to be taken because his plan is bigger than ours. And not every time we will understand. Like Job, sometimes we go through some terrible situations, but it is for the glory of God. Oh my goodness, how can I be the one to be in the position of loss and really fathom that and accept that? How? Well, we can start by understanding that the loving God that we serve did not make us with the intent for us to die. But the universe operates with a balance, and there are consequences if certain things happen. And one of the things that happened is that sin was introduced into the equation. And God says, where there is sin, then death is inevitable. It's an unfortunate consequence of the virus, the malady, sin. Now, in Jude, as we read, there is only one that can keep us from falling. And when we think about falling here, it is relevant in the context of us as human beings sinning. Let's say you fall out of the grace of God, you fall. But it has also deeper meanings, because mankind would have fallen from the status that God would have made us. Fallen because of these circumstances. However, that fall does not have to be a permanent fall, because God has a plan of restoration for us. So in the midst of our temporary existence on earth, we will have the kinds of falling down and getting up, as the song say, I fall down but I get up. It means I make mistakes but I take myself up, I correct, I go back to the Lord, and I get up and go. However, there is a fall that can happen that can be permanent. And that fall is when we allow ourselves to stay down with our condition of hopelessness without turning to the one who is able to permanently keep us from falling. That fall that I'm talking about is after we would have lived our lives up and down, but we end up in one place with Jesus. It seems as though we fell. And those who don't understand may think, When we get to the point of the grave, we are now down and out. Jesus says we're just asleep. But the only one that can keep us in that state of not being seen as fallen permanently, forever, is the one referred to here in this verse. The one who can keep us from falling. And to do what? Present us what? Faultless. Look here. I am up here preaching. I may look the part. And one may say, oh, Elder Planter is a preacher. Faultless? Far from it. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But because of the death of Jesus, he's able to present us faultless. Faultless, what a wonderful news. Before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. So the fall, whatever kind of fall we experience as human beings, and these things that happen to us are lessons, because if I fall off here, no, it's a fall. But it's gonna hurt. Every fall that we experience hurts. But there is joy as we experience the fall, because we know there is hope. So joy in the midst of sadness. The fall creates sadness. But when we present ourselves in the midst of the fall, in the midst of the downturn, in the midst of the disappointment, in the midst of the hurt, there is exceeding joy. And it says, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, because what? He's the one who allows us to have that joy in the midst of sadness. And so I can't stand here and present you any other decorated story as to how to experience joy at this point, this low point of your experience. I cannot pretty anything else up. I cannot make a bouquet and give it to you and it satisfies. I can't. You know something else I cannot tell you? Because if I tell you that, and I'm not criticizing anybody that does that, God does not give us the right to judge, but he gives us a spirit of truth that we must speak. I cannot honestly stand here and give you a sense of hope and joy in your spirit to tell you that Simone is somewhere in a better place, looking down at us now, feeling good to see us. I cannot tell you that because it's not true. It is not true. The God who made us and know that we will die and know the state that you are in when you die tells us that it is asleep, that the dead knows nothing. We sleep and await his call. There is something after death, you know. And for you who pass off, it is the next thing you see. So if the second you lose your life, you lose breath, you know nothing else. The other thing you know is when Jesus calls your name. So for you, for me, for whomever of us who pass away, at that moment, the next thing we will know, when we wake up, is like, oh yes, it's just, I was just here, but Jesus is here now. Huh? But for us who are still alive, we know time passed because they are resting in Jesus, or otherwise
And when the time come, the call will be made. If I tell you otherwise, I'm giving you false hope, false comfort. The true comfort that I can give you is that our God tells us, and we will now go to John 11 as I wind down. St. John 11. Joy, we're still talking about joy in the midst of sadness. St. John 11. And remember the story of Lazarus and the crying of Martha and Mary and everything. And it comes down to a point when Jesus makes a statement. John 11, 25 and 26 is what I want us to focus on. Jesus himself, Jesus said unto her, that's Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever believeth, whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall what? Never die. And he asks, believest thou this? Why are you going to believe it? You believe it because Jesus would have passed through that stage as a human being and was successful on our behalf. And when he got out of that grave, he says, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. And he says, death, where is your sting? Grave, where is your victory? I have the key. And the one who has the key is the same one who is able to keep us from falling now, from falling after we would have died this death. Keep us until that day when he calls our name. Like how he said, Lazarus, come forth, called our name. And we rise to meet him and say, lo, this is our God. We have waited for you. Joy in the midst of sadness. We who are alive are the ones who experience that joy. We experience the sadness, but we experience the joy. I cannot speak for, against, or about the conversation that Simone will have with Jesus. I can't. God does not give us that authority. A lot of individuals who were standing at the cross, Elder, when Jesus was hanging there, they might have stepped aside for a minute to go use the restroom, Elder. And when they came back, they wouldn't have known what had happened. That up there, one of the notorious criminals gave his heart to Jesus. And Jesus accepted his genuine plea. So you and I can't have, we aren't given that privilege to make that call. When Moses passed off, Satan had an argument with God saying, this one is mine because he made mistakes. God said, you are crazy. Jesus didn't die yet, but in preparation, he said, this one is taken care of, not yours. But we who are here, while we grieve, while we are saddened by the loss, let us understand that we have every opportunity to be joyful because of the hope of salvation that Jesus gives and the fact that he has the authority to keep us from falling in every way, shape, or form. And the song says, in the eye of the storm, even if you fall, even if you fall, his angels he sent to bear you up And when you fall and think you would have broken your hand or your foot or hit your head, you get up and brush off and say, boy, I don't know nothing wrong with me. It might be simple, but we have to thank God for these things. But as we thank him for our daily victories, he wants us to understand that the ultimate victory that will make a difference to the fact that we have lived, we have served, we have given ourselves like Simone has, all of that will only be worthwhile if at the end of it all, we would have allowed ourselves to be in the hands and the care of the one who can keep us from falling. May God continue to be with all of us as we live on his promises and do our part to give him all the glory and praise. God bless you.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise him. Indeed, want to thank the elder for allowing God to use him, give us that timely message. As we prepare to pray for the family, we see the matriarch of the family holding up her hand. So at this time, I'm going to ask the family members to remain seated, and those who are otherwise to stand as Sister Beryl come forward. So the family members remain seated, and those who are otherwise, I'm going to ask you to stand. She wants to say a few words, so give her the opportunity.
Before I came alone, and it won't get better by the time I am gone. But if I had to turn, just give me a song, Lord, sing about you. For I love you, Jesus, and I love your name. It's been a long time ago, and I'm glad you came. So let others go on just doing what they wanna do, but it makes me happy, Lord, to sing about you. I'm only human, I'm just a woman, Lord help me believe, no lie believe, and all that I am. That I am to climb, Lord, for my sake, just teach me God to take one day at a time. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. One day at a time. Just one day, Lord. Sweet Jesus. That's all I'm asking. To do every day what I have to do. Yesterday is gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow in every mind.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord one more time. Let me hear you say, thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. We serve a mighty God. What do you say? We serve a God who is able, who cares. And all he asks of us to do is to take it one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus. And all I'm asking of you, Lord, teach me to take one day at a time. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed as we pray for the family members at this time. Great God, eternal Father, this afternoon we have come here in this building to magnify your name because you are worthy to be praised. We place before you, Lord, your children, family members who have lost their loved ones, but they believe that you are able, they believe that you are a present help in time of trouble. And so they have come into your house to worship you and to magnify your name. They have come, Lord, in thanksgiving and praise, because they know that it has been you who has been keeping them up to this point. They know that if they are to survive in this world, that they need your protection and your care. They know that they dare not walk alone, because closer than a brother, Jesus is to me. And so, Lord, I present them in your hands. I present them in your care, because they know that he who keepeth Israel neither slumber nor sleep. So although they know that the devil is like a roaring lion going about whom he may devour, they know that our God is a present help in time of trouble. Oh, let this time storm arise and the tempest blow, they don't worry me because I'm sheltered in the eyes of the storm. Almighty God, as I place them into your hands, so take care of them, Lord, as only you can. Some of them will be returning back to foreign lands. We pray, oh God, that you will give them journeying mercies. Yes, Lord, they are here today, but when they go to their beds tonight, they will be alone. But I heard somebody say that a little talk with Jesus makes it right, all right. And so as they speak to you, Lord, make it right in the name of Jesus Christ. And even as I pray for the family members, those of us who are here to witness this experience, Lord, we pray a blessing upon us also. Oh, Father, we thank you for your words because you allowed the disciple John to pen these words. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. And if it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again to receive you unto myself. That where I am, there will you be also. Bless us, Lord, as we leave here today. May your will be done in our lives. And we thank you again, Lord, for this family. Continue to bless them and continue to bless this community. May the legacy live on. I pray in Jesus' name. Let the church say amen. Amen. Let the church say praise the Lord. Praise. Let the church say thank you, Jesus. Because I tell you one thing that is worthy to be praised. We serve a mighty God. I want to sing this song before we close. What a mighty God we serve. Everybody. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. Bring them down.
What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before, heaven and earth adore. What a mighty God.
We have now come to the end of our service. This is not a funeral service. This is not even a Thanksgiving service, yes, but it's a memorial service.
Yes.
So I'm gonna pray and then you will be led out by the usher. Okay, let's bow our heads as we pray to close. The words of our mouth, meditations of our hearts, be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Just have one announcement to give, as you will be led out by the usher. That is Wednesday at UTEC. There will be a special memorial service. Begins at, it's 9 o'clock? 10 o'clock. It will be 10 o'clock. Which particular building will it be? Oh, the UTEC auditorium. So the family is inviting all of us to come and to share in that experience. Elder.
Yes, and I just want to acknowledge the gesture that would have been made by Brother Steve, and I can tell you that we will be praying for the ventures that you are contributing to, and we have been praying for the community and the direction that you are pointing in is the direction that we want to see this community go in. And whatever we can do as a church, as a matter of fact, as a church, we are putting in plans and policies to make sure that the church becomes more relevant to the community and the development of the community, because that is why we are here. So may God continue to bless you. I know you say you're not rich, and that's a good position to take, because everything belongs to God.
Amen.
But as you use it to do what you're doing, and it goes to his cause, he will continue to bless you. And we're praying that the Lord will bless you and your family. And if you are overflowing now, I ask that you will have a tsunami of overflowing. And so that you will have the ability to, and the family, to experience the dream and the goal for this community. And I know this community is going to become an example in this St. Andrew, based on the direction that is being taken. So thank you so much for the gesture, and may God continue to bless
you. Amen. Endorsed by all of us, Steve. And again, it's our privilege to have been part of this program. And you'll have noticed that I've been enjoying myself. The elder has been enjoying himself. And we all are happy to be a part of the world process. I personally will be at the Wednesday at UTEC. And so I ask that we'll continue to pray for the family and pray for our community. You'll be ushered, remain in your seats. You'll be ushered out by...
Go again, Wednesday. Sorry, you would have announced this already.
Yes.
But it is saying Wednesday, March 15 at 10 a.m. Yes. University of Technology.
Yes.
Alfred Sangster's auditorium. Right. Alfred Sangster auditorium.
Okay. I think they only have one auditorium there. They have more than one. So let's just repeat after the announcement. Thank you very much. My wife will come and she will usher. I will join her as we usher you out.
Thank you.